Hi. 1.5 years ago, I was leading one of my meditation group, and as always, I was sitting with this in my lap, the harmonium, just being ready to receive if something came in. And this day was very special because this little tune came in. Maria, 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 and so forth. It's a song for Mary. And since that, I've been doing it at my lectures and having the congregation to sing with me. And it's always moving and it's never the same. It's always different. But the other day, this is a few days ago, I was thinking that in my little workspace, I wanted to set up my keyboard. It was just, you know, you have this feeling that now it's time to do that. There I have a small altar. And I just placed it just in front of the altar. On that altar, there is an icon. This one. And this icon has a little story. In 2003, I went to Syria with a very good friend of mine, Anders Laugesen, and it was a kind of pilgrim's trip. For example, one of the places we wanted to visit was the biggest monastery for women, for nuns, in the whole Middle East, called Sidnaya. And we came there on a special feast day where they had an icon that is revered as being good for women who cannot produce children. So they, all those kind of women, they come there and they spend the night there, sleep there. And they, it's Jews, it's Christians, it's Muslims, it doesn't matter. They come there and they sleep. And there's so many stories of afterwards how they were suddenly able to be with child. But when we went in through the icon room and came out again, there in the shadows, right in there in the dark, I just saw this symbol icon hanging on the wall. And I could not get my eyes from it. And you can see on this picture that there is a break right through her hand in the heart section. And actually, it is called the Madonna of the Broken Heart. And while I was standing looking at it, a sister came to me and she said, I can see that you are very taken by this. This icon has a story. 50 years ago, it was lying on the floor. You see, it's just a very simple icon. It's something that is printed on a piece of cardboard and it was just ripped apart. And that young nun that found it, she made it her gift to God and to Our Lady to put it into this beautiful frame that she made herself. She had made everything herself, you know. And it had been hanging on this wall ever since for 50 years. And you're the first one who really sees it. So therefore, she said and took down the icon, you should have it. And if you will take care of that, she will take care of you, she said. I was completely, you know, you can imagine, I was totally dumbfounded. You know? And on our way out, there was a young novice who was following out to her car. And she said, just before she closed the door, sorry, maybe you would like to know that the sister who gave you this were the one who actually found it and made this icon 50 years ago. that made the story even so much more meaningful to me. A few days later, we were visiting a woman called Myrna of Sufnia. Sufnia is a small suburb to Damascus. And Myrna has since the 80s been a stigmata, meaning that every time the Passover comes together where all the three Christian churches are celebrating exactly on the same time, she is having her stigmata, meaning she is bleeding from her hands, from her side where the spear of Jesus were putting, on her feet and on her forehead. She's the most documented stigmata that history have ever produced. She also had in the 80s, during the 80s, some apparitions of Mary and had some messages that is now written in a book and so forth. But I brought this icon of the Madonna of the Broken Heart to her in order for her to bless it. And she brought it up to her small chapel on the roof of her house, with the family house. And there she made a ceremony for half an hour, praying for the icon. And afterwards, she just said, smell. Can you smell it? It smells of roses. And actually, that was happening. The whole room was filled with the smell coming from the icon. And you should imagine this is just an icon made of cardboard and, you know, very simple and with a lot of tape and everything behind it, just to keep, hold it together. How could that be? Mommy. But in that little song about Maria, there is one line that is saying, Mariam Mare. And in Aramaic, that Mare means master. And on the holy island of Athos, Mount Athos, some years ago, they found a manuscript called the Acts of Philip. In that manuscript, Mariam the Magdalene is named Mariamne Mara. Miriam was a very, very well-known name, of course, at the time of Yeshua. But it has many different ways of expressing itself, like Miriam, Mariam. And to me, Mariam the Magdalene, that was the name of Mariam Magdal. Mariam, or Mary, the Exalted One. And suddenly she presented herself in this song. So the other day, as I told you, I have set up one of my keyboards just in front of that altar. And the first thing, when I pressed the on button and the sound of strings came up, and suddenly I heard myself sing the words of Mary. And suddenly some new peace came in. It's really hard for me to explain to you because I was really there at the cross. And for me, that Mary that was standing there was a combination of all the Marys in the world. And for me, Mary here is the three Marys that is mentioned in the Gospel of Philip. You know, one of the Gospels that was not included in the New Testament, but that is still so powerful. And just listen to this. There were three who always walked with the Lord, three Marys, Mary the mother, Mary the sister, and Mary the Magdalene, whom they call his lover. And Mary is his sister and his mother and his lover, or his spouse or his wife. Just think about it. The three Marys representing the feminine principle of this day. The words that came in was, I saw you there standing, trembling by the cross. You were the thunder and the lightning that ripped the veil apart. In the Holy of the Holies, you were opening our hearts. I saw you there holding that wounded bird in your hand. Saw the tears you were hiding as you healed it by your command. It was not for him you were crying. It was for us. These words just was coming through me as I was singing. And I was so moved. And at that time, I was on my own in the house for a few days. So the next day, I took the song and wanted to record it in our little home studio.
I saw you there standing.
And when I came to this new piece, then there was one of the lamps in the living room that started to, like, a morse, you know.
In the Holy of the Holies.
And when I stopped playing, it stopped. I just thought, okay, I need to change the bulb or something. And when I started to play again, it came again. And it was especially when I played the new piece. I was just, you know, astonished, you know. At that time, I didn't think about getting a camera or anything to document it. But I did a few days later when Gita came, she took the camera and we tried to experiment with it. And every time I tried to change key, It didn't react. But every time I played the original key, and every time I came into the new piece, it started to react.
It was not for him you were crying.
And of course, this can be a coincidence, I know that. But to me, there's no doubt that it was a kind of communication that happens when we are. You should just imagine, after the day before, when I have been sitting in front of the altar and this song came in, this new part of the song came in, I was so filled up with this energy and had this feeling that I had to step aside so this thing could manifest. And that's another thing, you know, when we come to that place where the intellect cannot follow anymore, because the intellect always tried to find a solution. Why did this happen? That's obviously because of a bulb that needs to change. You know, it starts to, because we want to be in control. But when you leave that and you just keep yourself total neutral and open to whatever happens, things start to happen. It was a thing that also Dr. Jung, I'm not comparing myself to anybody, or at least not to him, but he also experimented with that. And he found out that things started to happen when he just allowed it to happen. And if you have dedicated yourself, for example, to prayer, what I did before, and meditation before all this happened, then you are connecting to a certain kind of vibe. And in this case, I was sitting doing it in front of Mary, you know, the Madonna of the Broken Heart. You know, like Myrna of Souvenir, the stigmata, said after the ceremony, she said exactly the same words as the sister who gave me this. If you will take care of her, she will take care of you. Meaning, I think that we now need to invite the feminine principle in, not a feminine version that is just another copy of the male. But in respect for the male and the male in respect for the female, that now we are going to work on equal footings everywhere and in everything. So that we need to understand what is the qualities of the masculine and what is the qualities of the feminine. And when they can work together in equality, we can actually read in the Gospels that then we can move mountains. Then we can really start to change things and transform things. And that is what this is all about. So hopefully this could be an inspiration for you and in your own work and in our common understanding of what the feminine principle and what the moon priestesses is. Because the three Marys were each and everyone moon priestesses, meaning that they have been through some kind of initiation where they have opened up towards their higher selves. So they were able to connect on an everyday level from the heart. Everything went through the heart for the Marys. So that's why I also find it very meaningful, the Madonna of the broken heart. Because to have a broken heart means to me that we have an open heart, a real open heart. And very often we need to have it broken, open, in order for the inner light or the inner shim to be able to shine out. We are actually carrying that moon priestess within us, as we are carrying the Messiah within us. So let them merge in the bridal chamber of the heart, and then we can start change this world, because it's so much needed right now. So here's that song that I have just been telling you all about, the original take. It's a song to the divine feminine in all women, to the Marys everywhere, because now is the time for the feminine to come forward and do what it was supposed to do and clear up the mess that we have made.
Thunder and the lightning.
Mariam Mare, Mariam Mare. I saw you there holding that wounded bird in your hand. Saw the tears you were hiding as you healed it by your command. It was not for him you were crying. It was for us. Mariam.